You know, the world could always use more heroes.
Wait, I swore I just saw Tracer use her blink ability more times than she's supposed to be able to. I had to see this again. All right, where is rewind, rewind, rewind? Okay, here it is. Right here. Okay, now play and okay, here we go. I hate you, Tracer. Genji's one of the newer characters, was actually released, so I actually had to tack this on because he got out right as I started the video. But he's extremely fast, kind of like Tracer, where he's extremely good at getting into the back line and then getting back out, you know, very, very quickly. The difference being is you'll really be relying on your deflect more than just going blink, blink, blink and being able to get back out of the fight. Genji is very, very malleable in terms of what you want to do. You can either throw a triple shuriken at single target, or you can throw a wider spread if you're looking to, like I said, catch another faster character like Tracer, who's, you know, jumping around. It's a lot easier to catch them if you can throw a nice wide spread, or you can always rely on just hitting your deflect button and maybe she'll actually kill herself. The big star, in my opinion, in Genji's kit is his deflect ability. In my experience, anything that is physical can be deflected. This includes actual abilities that can be... I've had my Roadhog hook get parried off with deflect before. So as long as it's something that's not like Winston's Taser or Tracer's Sticky Mine or Symmetra's Laser, you should be pretty good to go as long as you hit deflect in time. And a great deal of characters who can actually one-shot you, deflect will give you that survivability you need to be able to last. Wherever your deflect fails, your ult Dragon Blade will actually come in perfect help. It'll help you carve through Reinhardts left and right. Any tanks actually that are giving you an issue or anybody slower than you, Dragon Blade is there for that reason exactly. Your goal for that is just to run up, and you want to run circles around them and just hack away at their kneecaps or their face or wherever you really are not having a very good relationship with. And that's exactly what the character's built around. It's just being able to single out people, run them down, finish them off, and then get out with Swift Strike or even getting in with Swift Strike.
Justice ain't gonna dispense itself.
McCree is pretty good for any veteran FPS player looking for their first offensive character. And by veteran FPS player, I mean somebody with solid Twitch reflexes and a steady hand for accuracy, since that's kind of a requirement. So when you're playing as McCree, you'll want to abuse the ridiculously amazing accuracy that your Peacekeeper has at a distance. Anytime you have the chance, honestly. You're one of the few characters who actually poses a threat to snipers when you're actually not seen, so it's in your best interest to abuse this. McCree also has amazing amounts of burst. By using your combat roll's reload and the flashbang, you can set yourself up to mow down people whenever they decide to try to fight you. Unless you're me and you decide to whiff everything. Your ult Deadeye is actually going to be able to kill just about anybody, provided that they're not being protected by a shield. So, main threats against you are going to be anybody that can provide shields to their allies. So, Zarya, Reinhardt, Winston, people like that will definitely put a damper on your day. But you also have to look out for other people. Since your gun only shoots technically one bullet at a time, hypermobile characters are really going to give you a little bit of a hassle as well. So people like Tracer, or even sometimes Lucio. I know for me, I've killed quite a few McCrees in my day. And it's definitely something you need to look out for. Overall, I was initially drawn to McCree just based on his aesthetics. And, you know, he's not bad, but I'm not really an offensive-minded person. I'm more of a support or a tank player, but you know, he's definitely got his uses on certain levels, and if you really have those Twitch reflexes, I highly suggest that you give him a try.
I will protect the innocent.
If you enjoyed a certain old-school series called Tribes, Pharah is perfect for you. She comes equipped with a ton of movement abilities, and she heavily depends on the verticality of combat to get any sort of advantage in it. When you're playing as Pharah, you'll want to take the height advantage every chance you get, meaning outdoor maps such as Dorado or Watchpoint Gibraltar are perfect for you. Pharah is pretty straightforward. You just want to shoot rockets at people. You can either use the rockets to directly kill people, or as the most common strategy currently is to use it as suppressing fire to just get people away from a doorway. But there is a few quirky things you can do. So you can use Pharah's concussive blast to push yourself a little bit if you need to. Now, this only will work when you're standing on the ground, and it's not really optimal or advised if you don't have to. You're definitely at your most vulnerable as Pharah when your jump jet is on cooldown, so you need to either make sure you end your movement while you have the height advantage, or you need to end it in some sort of hiding place since you're so weak. Surprisingly, your main weakness as Pharah is your lack of horizontal movement speed. I know for a fact that I've been hooked in midair, and I have hooked a lot of Pharahs in midair, playing as Roadhog, or even just being able to snipe them out, you know, as a Widowmaker. And I'm not really that good of a sniper, honestly. But the biggest thing is the snipers, actually. You want to look out for those, as when you're in the midair, you're going to stick out like a sore thumb, and you're just asking to be shot in the head. Still, if you can actually discern where the sniper is, you know, Widowmaker and or Hanzo, then you can actually identify the blind spots where you can actually go into the air and get an advantage for your team by pushing forward and getting rid of certain targets.
Death walks among you.
Reaper requires an interesting way of thinking. Like, he's got great potential to take out targets that other people otherwise have no business even being around, such as getting up to a bastion that's turreted up in a corner where nobody's really able to get there, but you know, with your abilities you can easily get right behind him and flank him and take him out. Or even simply hiding in a corner, like I'm doing right here, which is kind of mean. I don't feel very good about doing it, but honestly, I really suck with this character, so I was kind of just looking for new opportunities. I think this was the first game I've ever played as with him, so I was hoping to show off a little bit of what he does, which is, you know, being able to get behind other characters and then put a huge amount of damage on them, and then potentially get out with his Wraith form. I'm pretty sure when I was playing this game was the first day that Genji was available, and you really have to look out for him, honestly. Especially with his deflect, he's pretty much able to just ricochet all that shotgun damage right back in your face, and you can easily end up killing yourself if you're really not paying attention. So always wait him out, wait until the deflection's about to be over, and then finish him off. That's always your best bet, and you're gonna have to learn the timing on that perfectly. What you'll really want to do is use your teleport to get into really good positioning, and then just swoop down like Batman and just start just destroying people in their backline, where their tanks are really out of position, and by the time they could respond, it's already too late. But make sure you can also get out, and don't back yourself into a wall like my stupid self there. Your Death Blossom, when used appropriately, has the potential of easily turning an entire game around in your team's favor. Or you can just assume everyone's going to be around the corner, and all you're really going to get is a single D.Va, and then you're going to be running for your life because their Hanzo is just going to be perfectly in range to snipe you a couple of times. You're going to jump like an idiot. But you see the point. You're supposed to get right in the middle of their team, jump down, Death Blossom, blow a bunch of people up, and then finish the game off with style.
We're all soldiers now.
If you want to learn how to play this game, this is where you start with Soldier 76. He is the quintessential generic FPS character, but he's got a little bit of quirks to him also. He does have his own heal, which you can see here in the game right here. It'll actually let me win this fight. He's got a nice high damage rockets, but for the most part, it's going to be all about you actually being able to aim your gun properly and know exactly where to go on the map. Now, you're not going to be able to do anything super flashy like a Reaper or a Tracer or anything, but if you do manage to get in the correct positioning with this character, and usually that's about medium range, which you'll see all over this video, and especially if you can pop the ult, this kind of stuff will happen. Bam, just like that, you'll take the point all for yourself. Well, technically for your team, but yeah, we all know who did the work. Be sure that you're using your sprint whenever you're not in combat. Just run. It'll enable you to actually catch just about anybody, as most people in this game don't have a movement ability that can be constantly on. Most of them will have like a teleport, or like in McCree's case, a combat roll. Most of them are not going to be able to outrun you, and when it comes to even short sprints, most people won't be able to get away from you. The biggest things you're going to need to look out for as Soldier 76, anybody long range, so snipers can easily take you out. And then anybody short range, which would include Reaper, even McCree with his burst damage will be able to take you out. Roadhog hooks, not so much. I have lost fights to Soldier 76 and I actually have won, but for the most part, stay medium range and you're gold.
Cheers, love! The cavalry's here!
For as much as I complain about Tracer, I can't stress enough how amazing she actually is, especially if you know what you're doing. You definitely need Twitch reflexes, and you most definitely need to know positioning, because if you are not in the right position, you will get blown up with your tiny, tiny amount of 150 health, and you need to be very, very cautious that every move you make is calculated to the nth degree, which really separates the good Tracers from the great ones. Your goal is to flank people, and that can involve getting behind a Reinhardt, or you can whiff your ult just like there, but you can throw your blink out just like this and then get right behind him and start really hitting the soft spots, or you can go right for the healer. Whenever your group is complaining, hey, somebody go for the healer, you can be that person most definitely, as you can sneak behind people and they're not even gonna know you're there, because there's no real way to discern which direction you went unless they know that optimum position that you're going for. Tracer's ult actually gives her a great ability to take out anybody who's set up or dug into a certain position. So Torbjorn turrets, I can't even say that very well, are easily taken out by her mine, and then Bastions are easily killed by her mine at the same time. Just make sure that you get behind him and then throw it, otherwise it'll be stuck to the shield and it's not going to do anything to him. Also of note is that Roadhog is actually not killed by the proximity mine, so make sure if you're going to throw it that he's at least damaged a little bit before you do. Other than that, just get behind the opponent, hit those soft spots, and eventually you're going to win. I can always tell when a new group of people got invited to the beta, because you'll see this huge influx of double Bastion on other teams, or Bastion Reinhardt, Bastion. It's pretty much what you'll see, and he's a great character to start with. If you're looking to defend a point, or even just like right here, I'm on the attack and I'm just trying to carve out an area of control, Bastion can definitely lock down that control and give your team at least a little bit of a foothold, so you can at least start taking objectives. Now, small disclaimer, when this video was done, there was that huge instant where they were doing the stress test, and there's a lot of lag, so bear with me on this one, but you need to find the great spots inside of each level, and because Hollywood is relatively new, the biggest thing to really do is just to park Bastion's big butt right on top of the frickin' car, and then just ride it in. But, eventually, there's a lot of flank points, like right here, a guy came up from behind me and just destroyed me. There's not really much you can do in that point. You just gotta be able to watch your flank, or at least have a teammate who can do that for you, and then you'll be able to carry your team relatively easily. Now, if you don't have a teammate, the best places you'll want to look for are corners, or places where you can cover 50% of your 360-degree radius. So, a corner somewhere is perfect. Most corners won't have any kind of vision to help you out, but if you can find it, it will be absolutely amazing and something you should definitely go for.
With every death comes honor. With honor, redemption.
Now, I'm not a sniper by any means. That's my full disclaimer right off the bat on this one. But if I had to come up with some way to describe how to play Hanzo, it's similar to playing with the AWP or the noob cannon in Counter-Strike, where, you know, if you land one hit and it's halfway decent, you're gonna kill most people. And for tanks, you're gonna take two, maybe three. Now here's the good news. Even for me, who really sucks, you can tell by all the errant shooting of arrows that I've got here. I kind of figured, I have infinite ammo, why does it matter? You still have some things you can do, and the biggest one is granting vision with your, I forget what it's called, honestly. I'm just gonna call it like the detecting arrow, I guess, for now. But you can see right here, I just kind of started rapid firing arrows, and I just ran in and cornered him, and then it kind of enabled my team to finish him off. Now, the other thing you need to actually abuse when you're playing Hanzo is your ability to climb walls. Notice that, you know, I could actually get up there to my left here, but our Farah just tried to get up there and just got mowed down instantly. So what I'm doing is I'm just kind of waiting for an angle I can take here, and it eventually comes when we kind of see that them backing off, and then our, you know, one of our teammates activates her ult, the Infrasight, and it shows me, you know, the Bastion's not in turret form anymore. So I'm going to scale this wall, and I'm going to go over here. I'm going to go and try to catch their flank, and it pays off pretty well. You can see I'm already actually going for the point right now. Now, the biggest thing I've seen with Hanzo is he's very good at locking down an area, or zoning is the technical term, especially with his ult. There's two different uses for the ult. Right here, I'm throwing it out so I can zone the rest of their team away from coming over to the objective so we have enough time to take it. And the big thing you notice is you'll see that happen, and that's because the dragon still is going all the way back to their spawn point. So that's something that you can definitely abuse as Hanzo. So as I go through a lot of these, especially with the defense characters, you're going to start to hear the word zoning a lot. And Junkrat, that's definitely the name of the game for him. Your goal is to just dump a bunch of explosives everywhere and make it really hard for people to move around inside of whatever area that you're lobbing explosives into. Now, if you have another player on your team who's playing a character who wants them to be bunched up, like a Farah, then Junkrat's probably not going to work too well. Most of the time when Junkrat's lobbing grenades everywhere, people tend to separate into one-man groups, and that's not really very good team synergy at that point. I found Junkrats to be pretty hard to use, honestly. I mostly just enjoyed just zoning people out by just lobbing grenades everywhere. If somebody actually happens to make it up to your face, it's very difficult to actually get away from them as Junkrat. The best thing you can really do is throw your little mine on the ground and then jump to a higher area, and that's really all you're going to be able to do. Before that, the best bet is just try to stand on top of them, because he does have a passive where he drops a ton of explosives on death. Now, through all this zoning talk, I definitely need to mention that Junkrat has one of the better ults in the game. And what it really is a remote-controlled tire that has a ton of explosives attached to it. So if there's somebody sitting in their backline who is just being really annoying and they need to die, boom, they're dead. Just like that, and they're out of commission, and they're not going to be able to help their team for the next, you know, 10-15 seconds, depending on what timing of the map that you're in. Granted, pretty much what you should be doing is just lobbing explosives the whole game. There should never be a single moment where you're not shooting explosives at people. So right here, we've got some guy running up in my face, I zone him backwards, and I shoot him in the face with a grenade. They do detonate as soon as you hit somebody in the face, so you can shotgun people with it if you really want to, but it's really not advised, as people shouldn't even be getting that close to you in the first place.
Our world is worth fighting for.
So Mei is one of those newer characters, and she's definitely got some unique mechanics going for her, such as the ability to completely separate a Reinhardt from his team to the point where they can't even help him out. It's a very great mechanic. Actually, in almost any game I've ever played, being able to separate somebody like that is always a positive ability as long as you use it at the right time. The other positive thing that Mei has going for her is her basic attack actually will slow people down to the point where they literally can't do anything. They're just frozen in place. And this enables your team to actually run up and be able to finish them off. And it's great for taking down Tracer in particular. Reaper, not so much, as he will be able to kill you before you can actually slow him down to the point where he's easily killed. But for the people running around that are just a little too fast for your team, Mei is a perfect choice for disabling them. The other thing is, with Mei's ult, you need to realize that the best time to use that is in any form of an extended engagement. And that will be the best, the time it can really show its strength, where it freezes the entire enemy team. A lot of people use it right before they die, and it's not a bad use, but it's not a great use either. I've seen it one time completely disable an enemy team, and then the rest of her team was able to pick up all the kills. But again, that was because her team decided to create an extended engagement on top of the Blizzard. And that's something that your team's going to have to realize, and really not something you can rely on in a solo queue mentality. Now, obviously, you are significantly squishy in the fact that you only have 250 health, but you do have a self-heal slash, I guess you'd just call it an ice block ability. So if you do use it sparingly, you'll be able to survive and definitely be able to slow the targets that are, you know, needing to be slowed or need to be taken out very quickly. They won't be able to really run away from your team. They'll just drop dead pretty fast.
Build them up, break them down.
A lot of the same advice that I've given for Bastion can actually apply to Torbjorn as well. Separate but together is the biggest thing that you need to realize. You should still be somewhere around your turret most of the time, and make sure that it keeps your health, and make sure that when you hit the turret, you're actually hitting it with the hammer. Most of these hits right here you're seeing in the video, I didn't even hit the turret. It's because I just was missed. That one missed. That one hit, but you can see the difference. Big things for Torbjorn. With his ult, you have infinite scrap. You should be just throwing armor packs on the ground like it's nobody's business. Throw it out like they're going out of business. That's what you gotta do. And biggest things you gotta know with the turret placement, place it either somewhere with foliage. There's a lot of foliage on like Numbani that you can hide it in, that's perfect. Or throw it somewhere where you can hide around the corner and keep healing it. Those are the two best ways to actually succeed as Torbjorn, and using that, you'll definitely win.
One shot, one kill.
So I'm going to take a little bit of a different tact here when it comes to Widowmaker. Because I'm so bad at sniping, number one, I'm just going to let the video go and just do whatever it wants. So if I drop dead, then that's obviously because I'm bad. But I'm going to go a different way and say, here's the things that you should do as Widowmaker, because I personally find them super annoying. And by annoying, I mean they tend to dominate games. Number one, find a clear line of sight on a very large straightaway. So where I'm kind of hovering around right now, this is a pretty good place for you to stand, on at least on Watchpoint Gibraltar, because you have most of the coverage here, and you can see pretty much everybody, and this is a great place to stand. The problem is a lot of people figured it out, so you're going to need to keep your eyes open for being flanked or people just trying to jump you in general. Use your Venom Mine as much as you can, at least just to give you knowledge that, hey, somebody's there. Kind of like what I did right there, is I know someone's there because the mine got triggered. Of course, now he knows I'm up here as well, so he's trying to jump me. The third thing, use that grappling hook for mobility. Don't just use it to get up to high places. Use it to run. Use it to do whatever you need to do to survive and to be able to help your team more often. Now, don't do what I just did, which is run into the middle of the fight screaming, help, 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 and lead their clearly better character right into the middle and able to assist his team. Basically, if you watch this video and you don't do the things that I'm doing, you're probably going to absolutely destroy the enemy team. And as long as you're doing at least a couple of the things that I'm saying, you're going to at the very least be an annoyance and be able to zone out people from certain areas or to cling to walls or something like that. And eventually that'll lead to a win for your team.
play to win.
Honestly, I know that they gave new star ranks to a lot of the heroes in terms of like how difficult they are, but I find that D.Va to be insanely easy, especially because she seems pretty much built to counter the tank meta. So if you look into kill tanks, she's perfect for that, you know, just taking down the front line. That's pretty much one of your good things you can do. You can also use your boosters to get up and over into their back line and then, you know, start to split them apart that way, or you can even just dash at somebody with your ult up, you know, block all the bullets, and then blow your mech. And that tends to send people into at least enough disarray to where even a semi-organized team can take advantage. Honestly, she's one of the most well-rounded tanks out of everybody. You know, Reinhardt's just the slow-going, pushing guy, has damage but has to get in your face. Roadhog has to land a hook. Winston is Winston. He just kind of pushes stuff and pushes people off of objectives. And then Zarya really only works unless you have another tank on your team, and that just leaves D.Va, who's got great attack strength. She's got good utility when it comes to being able to block the bullets, being able to dash out of a bad situation, even being able to use the mech as a blockade, which is something that a lot of people don't seem to realize and can get extremely annoying. Of course, all of this comes with some caveats, such as, you know, you're gonna get killed by snipers. That's just kind of how it is. You do get the second life when it comes to when you lose when you're in the mech, and you'll jump out of it and you can run around. And your damage doesn't suck when you're in that form. You still have a gun with 20 bullets in it, and it does deal a lot of damage, and they are fairly accurate. I mean, the reticule is super tiny. And like I said, even in your smaller form, you're built to kind of kill tanks. You're a lot faster than them, you can outmaneuver them a lot more easily, and it's only really going to take a full clip before you get that mech back up. Now bear in mind, while your mech is coming up, it is able to be hit and take damage. Now, while that is happening, it's not really going to affect you that much because it does have so much armor, and you're really built for long-term engagements, but just be sure that if you're about to get your ult, you know, don't be too aggressive.
Justice will be done.
Reinhardt's pretty simple, honestly. Stand in front of your team. Don't let them die. Use your health and shield properly. And, I mean, as long as your team attackers are actually able to follow up on your defense, then you should be good. The other things, there are some little quirky things you have to know. So when you're doing your little shoulder charge, you do have a little bit of control as to what direction you're going in by hitting your, well, on my keyboard it's A and D, but you know, basically strafing left or right will give you a little bit of turn, and using that can actually enable you to hit proper targets. As far as I've seen, when it comes to doing the shoulder charge and catching people, I usually just do it like it's an intersection, and most of the time somebody will not be looking left, right, left, and they'll get run over and destroyed. So, other than that, you know, make sure that you keep people behind you. If they happen to get caught, or if they happen to be destroyed, then, you know, they should have been behind you. Or they should have known that you were going to drop your shield, or whatever, but either way, you should be defending your team as much as you possibly can. So right here, catch somebody in the intersection, run them down. As for Reinhardt's ult, anytime that you can get a shoulder charge off, and you can turn around and stun their whole team, definitely go for it. If anything, your team will at least follow up, or you can at least mop the floor. Oh, and watch your shoelaces. Yeah, for the Bastion. I think it's safe for me to say that Roadhog is a tank killer. You've got a hook, which is easier to hit other people with, especially if they're bigger. And you've also got a shotgun, basically, that more bullets hit the target if they're bigger. Suffice to say, you know, I tend to go for tanks a lot, and he's quickly become one of my mains, mostly because if you land the hook, majority of people are just kind of drop dead within a few seconds. Now, a few things to note, I do have a lot more comments on this one since he is basically my main at this point. I found that, first of all, if you land the hook, make sure you go shotgun blast, melee, and then you shotgun them again. Don't just go shotgun. Like, you make sure you get that melee in, because that's an extra little bit of damage that can make the difference. Secondly, I've found that when I jump and throw my hook, it tends to hit more often, honestly. And I don't think it's because more of them is visible or anything. I think it might be because people don't expect it. That's really the only thing I can come up with. And, you know, I highly suggest at least trying it, you know, just to see how it works out for you. Maybe it's just a quirky thing that works for me, but you never know. Now, obviously, fast reflexes will still end up helping you, just like with any other character. So right here, the Junkrat opposing us is activated as Riptire, and I was looking for it. And I could have hooked it and probably saved him, but, you know, I'm going to die if that happens. And I was trying to get in front of the Bastion at that last minute, and I really wasn't quick enough to be able to absorb a lot of damage. And that's something else you can do definitely with Roadhog, is that you can walk in front of somebody or, you know, block an area and just stand there and use your heal. The other thing he's got, his ult pushes people. That's the biggest thing. It's not really damage. It's going to take you forever to be able to kill anybody. But for the most part, it's made for pushing people off of, well, anything. Off of a capture point, off a cliff, wherever you find it most suitable is going to be the best. Just don't really use it for damage. That's pretty much not a thing that you should be doing. It can kill people, for sure. I'm not discounting that. But you should be using it mainly for pushing people around. Right now, Roadhog's not quite in the best position because Genji exists and a lot of people are playing man-to-man aggression. But, you know, if you are very confident in your hooks and you think you can catch, you know, most people, then I highly suggest giving him a try.
Imagination is the essence of discovery.
I could easily tell right off the bat when I first started the closed beta that Winston was going to be that character where, you know, I really want to know how to play this character, but I'm just eternally doomed to suck with him because either nothing fits in my head that I can understand how he works, or I just won't be able to play him just by virtue of unluckiness or just, you know, being bad, or I just don't have the mechanics necessary. Something along those lines will probably prevent me from never being able to truly master him. But Winston's biggest strength is being able to get people off of a certain point. So if you want to establish a foothold somewhere, Winston's good for that. Winston plus Sebastian is actually amazing at that. And I honestly believe that the shield that he puts on the ground is probably the best basic ability in the game, in that it essentially gives your entire team under it a shield that absorbs everything. And if your timing's good enough, you can prevent a lot of things with that. Sniper fire, hooks, almost anything actually will be able to be blocked by the shield. So right here, I put it here in the corner, and that enabled the Junkrat to kind of move out in safety, not be sniped or anything like that. It's also giving that, you know, the, not presence of mind, I can't really think of the term right now, but peace of mind, there we go. It gives your team the peace of mind that, hey, I'm not just going to get completely blown out the second that I round this corner. I do have a few gripes about Winston. He doesn't actually bring enough to the table that somebody like Reinhardt or anybody else does, and his ult is really lackluster in my opinion. It doesn't do a lot of damage. All it does is fling people in all directions, and I really wish that he had an ability that wasn't just a jump to like ground pound and knock people away. But, you know, if you're into that kind of thing, pushing people off objectives, you know, rallying people around you, then yeah, he's definitely great at that.
Together we are strong.
I actually don't have a lot of experience playing or playing against Zarya, but in my experience, she's really difficult, honestly. You're not going to be getting many kills, because your laser doesn't exactly lock onto people, you just kind of drag it across, and I actually don't really know your real goal. I think your real goal is just to bunch people together, and then to zone with your laser. You're really not supposed to kill people. You're going to eventually, you know, you're going to get eliminations, you might even get final blows, but for the most part, your goal is going to be to bunch people up for other people to ult and finish off, or to zone certain areas. So here I launched my ult into the back because I saw that the Lucio was trying to run, and I really did not want him to run and be able to provide more healing. Now here I'm just doing suppressing fire, and that's really all I can bet on, and then again, Genji jumped down and just killed everybody. But that's really all I can think that she can do. I do know that she's better with a second tank, and that's why I don't have much experience, because whenever I see a tank, I don't tend to actually want to lock another tank. Or if I do, I don't want to lock somebody like Zariah. I'd rather play somebody that can deal damage, like Roadhog or D.Va. You know, somebody a little more mobile or can deal more damage is a lot more fitting with a Reinhardt than anybody else. Now, she does have some interesting quirks in that if you give your plasma shield to another tank, it's going to power up your weapon, and it makes it ridiculously powerful. I'm talking, if you drag that 100% beam on a Reaper for 1.5 seconds, he's going to drop dead. And it's very, very hard to maintain that 100 at all times. But if you can, it is extremely, extremely rewarding and powerful.
Whew, come on, let's bring it together.
All right, here's a character I can give insight on. What you end up doing with Lucio is actually going to depend on your team composition. Sometimes you'll want to be the hit-and-run person, like kind of like a weird tracer. And sometimes you're going to be one of the guys that kind of hangs around with your tank and make sure that people stay off of them, you know, mitigating damage. It's really going to depend on what your comp needs. And same thing's going to go with your ult. Sometimes you'll want to use it to counter another ult. Let's say that somebody's going to summon, you know, like a Junkrat summons a Riptire. You might need to ult so that nobody dies from that. Or let's say that, you know, everyone's getting about to be mowed down by a Reinhardt who just earth shattered them all to the floor. You're going to want to ult to make sure everyone stays alive. You're also going to want to run up there and push them off. And that's one of the better abilities that defines, you know, how good of a Lucio player you're going to be, is being able to use that ability to push people off. Now, it does do a little bit of damage, as you can see right here. And you can use that little bit just to put you over. But you really got to know how much it's going to deal and make sure that it's going to kill them. Otherwise, you're just going to end up giving them an escape route. Now, one of my other favorite things to do is, as I'm kind of doing right here, and that's sneaking up behind Reinhardts. I really like to play chicken with Reinhardts. It's a stupid idea, but it's very, very rewarding. And especially if you know what you're doing, it's kind of like baited and outsmarted all rolled into one. So speaking of Lucio's ult, I actually use it right here because it's got a really good demoralizing side effect to the enemy team. And it's not really zoning, but it kind of is if you think of it that way. And you can use it to do that kind of stuff, and we end up taking this point because of that. Overall, I'd say that Lucio is the best support only because of how flexible he is. And if you can really be in tune with that flexibility in your team comp, you'll excel greatly with him.
Watching over you.
Mercy is fairly straightforward. You will want to find somebody to, well, latch onto, like a little virus, I guess, or a parasite, and you'll want to keep them healed up. It's like just left click for the heals, and then if they're just dealing damage, then right click for the damage amp. So here I decided to get with Pharah because she had great range and it's really wide open out here, so I wanted to amp her damage up since, well, number one, she looked like she's in a better position than most people for dealing damage, and then she moved out, so now I go, okay, well, I'm gonna move to the next target. Alright, so now I'm gonna amp this guy's damage, and he's gonna start to move out. I'm like, okay, well, it looks like we're starting to take territory. Ooh, it looks like that Roadhog over there is really low, but how do I get over there? Oh yeah, I can just jump to this guy. Alright, he's good. Yeah, he's topped off. I'm going to move over to this Roadhog and go ahead and heal him. Now, what I want to do is I want to amp this Roadhog. That's where I've been trying to get to this entire game, because it makes each one of those little pellets he shoots deal that much more damage. And you'll see him just mow down this D.Va in one shot right there. And then this Reinhardt really doesn't stand much of a chance either. And that's going to enable us to get the foothold. And that's really how you play the character. You just find somebody, latch on, amp their damage, make sure everybody stays up. And if you happen to screw up here or there, like I did here, you do have your ult to fall back on. And you want to wait for the optimum moment, but don't wait too long, as everybody's death timer is going at the same time. So you might hit it, but right as you hit it, somebody has gotten up and you might not resurrect them. They might have to come all the way back from the start. Now, obviously, your ult's going to get better the farther away from your spawn point you are. But
you know, always be sparing with it. It's going to definitely make or break how good you are or how good you play in a game. Other than that, stay together, keep your team healed. It's really that simple.
The true enemy of humanity is disorder.
I actually thought that Symmetra was pretty difficult the first few times that I played her. Her gun has really short range, and the alternate fire is super slow, but I came to realize she's just basically built around zoning, and as long as you keep your team filled up with shields, you know, if somebody drops dead, make sure that you give them another one when they come back, and you go after targets you can actually kill with your gun, so people like Tracer, mostly because you don't have to aim your gun. See how it kind of latches on there. And that Reinhardt, before I even realized it, was dead, because it does an atrocious amount of damage if people let it sit on them for too long. And the turrets alone can be used for scouting, or they can be used for, you know, actually just mowing people down. It does do a significant amount of damage to squishier targets. Now, for a tank, especially if they have a Winston, your turrets aren't really going to be much used for killing anybody, as he can just walk in the room and just spin in circles and spray lightning everywhere like it's a friggin' dance show, and he'll be able to just destroy all your hard work. Now, when you put the turrets on, you want to make sure that they're spaced correctly. So right there, when I put them a little bit apart from each other, that's what you want to do. The best range I've thought of is if it looks like a rocket from Pharah could destroy more than one, it's not very optimal. But if you can keep all of them out of reach and you can make it at least so you can get a lot of shocks out of it, then that's what you want to do. But for the most part, you're going to see them as scouting. So right now I know someone's in there, and I think he killed most of them. Yeah, he killed all three. But I did actually manage to take down that Genji before he could flank us, and they had to come in with a Roadhog to actually take down the entire defensive network that I had there.
True self is without form.
Arguably best support in the game right now. Zenyatta's Orb of Discord is just absolutely too insane to ignore. The bonus damage will actually enable you to defeat tanks if you can stay out of their range. You can even buy a little bit of time if you actually have your ult, because it does make you invulnerable, and it's a fantastic way to actually get your team to push into a point without really much fear of dying. The biggest fear you should probably have as Zenyatta is if you get put into melee range, you're probably gonna die. Just accept that fate and do as much as you can with whatever little bit of time you have left to be able to play before you end up dropping dead. But try to, obviously, since you know most of your attacks are line shots, like your basic and even the charge is a line shot, you're gonna want to aim for places that have a lot of choke points. You can see here that we're on King's Row. I'm really trying to get to the left of the bus a lot, because it's a lot narrower and more people can't get through there, and also it covers a lot more of the area with my basic attacks. Other than that, you'll want to throw your orb on anybody that would need constant amounts of healing. So somebody who's hit and running, like a Tracer who has an orb, pretty scary actually. And then for Orb of Discord, you want to throw on anybody that actually needs to be able to take amplified damage. And you'll be very surprised by how quickly people get mowed down when they've got this giant target above their head. Another interesting thing that most people don't seem to notice about Zenyatta is he only has 50 health, but he does have 100 worth of shield. So if you find yourself under fire, immediately find cover, and that shield will actually start to regenerate, as that is exactly how shields actually work in the game. So lesson learned there. If you got a lot of shields, just make sure to find some cover, and you'll be able to get it all back, and you won't need health packs for it. Other than that, play Zenyatta. Extremely, a little bit more difficult than usual, but extremely rewarding. So obviously, the game's got a little bit of work to do in terms of just a little bit of balancing here and there, but overall, it is extremely fun. It's got the ridiculousness of TFC mixed with a little bit of MOBA concepts, in that, you know, your team comp matters, and having a different person on your team is going to change everything drastically. Make sure, and anyone should have guessed that this game was going to cost money. All the signs were there, you know. changing your hero mid-game is actually a core concept here. And without charging just a price to get into the gate, Blizzard would not have been able to curtail that very well. And then people would end up just being unhappy that, you know, oh my god, so-and-so owns all the people and I only own the four that are free this week. So I lost because of that. You know, people would start getting really annoyed by that. And that's not really going to help you get that V in the end, just having that kind of frustration. And that's not going to let you have fun games like this one right here, which came down to the absolute wire. And it really came down to this ridiculous play of the game that's coming up right here, where my teammate just ran out and just blew the entire enemy team out. And it really was down to his pick. You know, I was frantically switching, trying to get somebody to get back into combat. And eventually it came down to this. And this was a overtime fight that went on for at least a full minute. It was insane. And you wouldn't be able to get that if they didn't charge for the door. So I hope you enjoy the video, guys. Please subscribe if you enjoyed, and thanks a lot.